So I feel like it's gonna be a fight where they're gonna clash, and somebody's gonna get that left hook to the body in, and who's gonna be able to now withstand that arsenal?
We haven't seen Canelo in one of those fights.
Huh?
We haven't seen Canelo in that
fight. Yeah, because a lot of guys are scared of Canelo. You know, Bivol wasn't, but you know, that's a different weight class. But when you see the fight with Charlo went there for a payday. Charlo ain't do nothing. So all we saw from Canelo was just walking him down one shot. Walking him down one shot. It was like when you see a batter warming up and he's just hitting home runs. It's target practice. That's all Canelo did in his last fight. But Munguia's not scared. Munguia's gonna come to win. And that's gonna bring a different side of Canelo. So I think we're gonna see a great fight between both fighters.
Last one for me, were you surprised to see Ryan Garcia beat Devin Haney?
No, I wasn't surprised. I was more surprised by the approach that Haney took. I was more surprised that Haney didn't jab. I was more surprised that Haney didn't put that hand up. Like, he kept the hand here, he never put it up. His whole camp, that hand should have been glued to the side of his face. Take away the hook, but he did. So I was more surprised by that. When he got dropped in the first round, I said, oh, they'll make the adjustment. He didn't make the adjustment. So what surprised me was just, you didn't take away his best punch, and you kept getting hit with it over and over, and you walked in naked, no jab. That's what surprised me more, because I knew that Ryan got the power to knock anybody out in that division. But it's, you can't help him out and give it to him. You can't just be out there with your chin out. So that's what surprised me, was that Haney didn't make the adjustment.
But why is it?
Huh? He don't need it. Haney didn't give him a check with a rematch. Why would Brian give him the rematch?
But why is a fighter, like, you don't make adjustments during the fight? Why do you think it happened?
I think what happened is you're in the moment. You never experienced that before. Bill Haney, he's done a good job with his son. But he's never been in that situation as a coach. This is big. It's New York. Your son got caught with a crazy shot. And it's not that it's just your fighter. It's your son. So in that moment, he's telling him what to do offensively. But what I would have done, and if I'm in Haney's corner, I would have said, bro, the next round, just get on your bike, recover, get your strength back, and we come back in the third round. Don't try to play him punch by punch. You know, you got hurt. This is a 12-round fight. So let's take this next round off, recover, and then come back next in the third round and keep that hand up, keep your guard up. You know what I'm saying? Those are things. But he came in wanting to get that shot back, and that just hurt him because he was the one that was being the aggressor, and Ryan was the one that was being the counterpuncher, just stepping back. You know what I'm saying? So it's a learning process.
Gabe, who's the best at 140?
At 140, Ryan's the best at 143. But at 140, man, you know what I'm saying? It's like, you know, it just depends. Because, you know, you got 35 and 40. You're so close. And Tank is 35. And then you got Isaac Cruz, who just won the 35. At 140, the guy is Matias. You know, he's making his debut with Matchroom. But can you imagine Teofimo? You know what I'm saying? But Teofimo, to me, I wouldn't say he's the best because he's inconsistent. One moment he shines, and then one moment is a dud. So, you know what I'm saying? So it's hard. I think it's right there for the taking because these guys are so kind of even where it's just right there for the taking. I don't really think there's one that stands out that you go, this is the top guy at 140. If Ryan would have made the 140 and would have became champion, then you gotta put him in the top at 140. But he didn't make 140. So can we call him on 140 or is he a welterweight?
Does that tarnish his win, the blowing weight?
Nah, man, because, you know, boxing at this point, this is prize fighting. This is about entertainment. The majority of fans really ain't tripping about weight. They just wanna see what they saw, which was a crazy action-packed fight. You know what I'm saying? Like, people like that are true boxing fans, you know, they think about weight, but, you know, the average boxing fan just wants to be entertained.
So, when
do you give any chance to Craig Martin upsetting Tank Davis at 135, Team 14?
I mean, anything can happen, but you know, I think Tank is just that dude. You know, sharp, counter puncher, good power. You know what I'm saying? So I'm not counting Martin out, but you know, Tank's that guy at the weight class.
Well, you see thanks that rematch to him and Ryan, either 143 to catch weight, or
say it again.
You see that rematch between Tank and Ryan at some point?
I don't even think Tank. That's why Tank did the hydration clause. He knew that Ryan, if he's that, he already said that Ryan could crack, and that was Ryan being depleted. Imagine Ryan, you know, fully being strong and having this weight and keeping that on. You know, it might be a different ballgame. So I think Tank stays away from that. But look, man, Tank is a special fighter, right? Tank is a special fighter, man. So Tank is the kind of fighter where he knows how to make adjustments. So, you know, and money talks, and I think that rematch is big. That rematch should be big. So money talks, man. So, and if that rematch was to happen, it's 50-50. It's 50-50.
I think another fight that potentially will sell is Pitbull Cruz and Ryan. Pitbull is huge, has a lot of, you know, people following him. So styles make fights. How would you break down that fight if Ryan fought
That's a great action fight with Cruz, but Cruz just became champion at 35. So he became champion at 35?
40.
Oh, 40. Okay. Sorry, my bad. Oh, yeah. So he became the champion at 40. But my thing is this. Ryan's talking about that he can't make that weight. Ryan's saying he's coming up to 47. And I think he's better at 47 just because he's tall. He has that height. He's 26, I believe. So now your body starts developing to that man body, where it's hard to deplete yourself and drop that weight. So I see Ryan being more effective at 147. I don't really think it would make sense for Ryan to drop down to 40.
Ryan also mentioned going to up to 154 and fighting Fundora. What do you think? Like that height difference and everything?
Listen, for real, stylistically, I love that fight. Stylistically, I love that fight. You got, you know what I mean? Like, that's a great fight. And I think, damn, I don't even know how to call that fight, but I would actually like to see that fight. That's dope.
How would you? 147.
Ryan said he's wanting to fight Spence now with the whole drama.
Spence can't make 47. You know what I mean? That's a 40. He's a 54-pound fighter, man. It doesn't make no sense for Spence to hurt himself and try to get down to 47. I'm hearing talks of Ryan talking about that he'll fight Boots at 47. Yes. Man, you know, Ryan loves to put himself in fights where it's like, damn, where you kind of scratch your head. But it's like...
kind of like you. I mean,
yeah, for sure. Yeah, but the thing is, that's rare. And that's what made the fans love me and respect me, was because I took those fights. The people were like, what? That's crazy, right? I would move up in weight and things like that. And I think that's what gave me longevity in the sport, because it was like, yo, win, lose, or draw, gay fighting, whoever. And I think Ryan, you know, by him going up against Tank, and he took that L, but he bounced right back. And then he went against Haney, like, damn, Haney? And then he does what he does. It's like, you know, I think more fighters need to take key to that and realize that, yo, it's not really about protecting that. Oh, that's whack. It's really about facing the best. And win, lose, or draw, if you put on a great fight, the fans are going to love you. The fans are going to want to see you. Because would you rather see a guy who's undefeated but is boring to watch because he's just boxing? Not that boxing is boring, but I'm saying, like, not having a guy with a boxing style is boring, but I'm saying, like, you know, if you're seeing a guy that's just tapping, it was like Rigondeaux. It's the Rigondeaux effect. Rigondeaux, how good was he? He was great, but he wasn't entertaining. So would you rather see that? Or would you rather see a guy that comes in there, gun blazing, boom, 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 and he's throwing it out there, fighting smart, but he might win some, he might lose one, but he's entertaining.
Yeah, talking about fighters taking fights that, you know, are surprising. Mike Tyson's fighting Jake Paul, man. You know, I'd be saying that out loud. What do you think about that?
Look, man, it's good for the sport of boxing. It's going to probably be the most watched fight in the history of the sport. You know what I'm saying? It's on Netflix, so it's another network. Netflix? Who don't got Netflix? Everybody got Netflix, so everybody going to watch this fight. You know what I'm saying?
I think it's with 16-ounce gloves, right?
We haven't got all the info yet. But
who cares? These are heavyweights. So, you know what I'm saying? They're heavyweights. And yeah, you know, Jake is young. So he got the youth. He can box. He got power. So it's like, but at the end of the day, it's Mike. That's a legend, right? So I think it's good. I think it's good for boxing, man. I really think it's good for boxing.
What do you favor in that matchup from what you've seen, you know, from the clip you've seen?
The first three rounds, I favor Mike. It's going to be real dangerous for Jake in the first three, four rounds. Real dangerous. Because Mike looked good against Roy. Mike looked real good against
Roy. Roy wasn't trying to mix it up with him too much.
So it's going
to
be real dangerous for Jake in the first three, four rounds. But I think that, you know, Jake will probably try to tire Mike out. You know what I'm saying? But look, man, this is a great fight. They can both punch, and it's going to be good for boxing.
Gabe, you're probably the, how do I say it? So did you watch Fundora and Two?
Yeah.
That cut? You're probably the person that I should ask about how a cut affects a fighter in there.
Yeah.
And do you think if there was no cuts, would Team Zhu look better in that fight?
No, I just think that Team Zhu's corner should have been more experienced. And been like, yo, we're not going to be able to stop this cut and end the fight where it goes to a no contest and you protect your fighter and he keeps his belt. Because the cut was too bad. And it was in a part of the head where that blood is just going to keep flowing. You know what I'm saying? And it's like, you got to protect your fighter at that time, in that moment. And Zhu's not going to quit. He behaving like a fighter. That's the corner's job to stop the fight and be like, yo, this ain't good. He's handicapping my fighter. He's going to lose this fight. You know what I'm saying? And then the cut, man, like, I don't even know if he was experienced. You got to – look, in championship fights, you got to have the best of your best in your corner. So, you know, I think that was a fumble right there, but I think his corner should have protected him.
So is that true? If blood gets in your eye, you cannot see anything?
Yeah, you can't –
fighting blood?
Yeah, you can't see. And then you're not – you know, they're probably not using the proper medicine. He doesn't have the experience. And my thing is this, like, if you have a cut, man – who knows about cuts? Because you can't have a surgeon. Just because you're a surgeon, that doesn't mean nothing. You got to have an experienced guy that knows about fight, a boxing match, and knows about cuts from a boxing match standpoint, right? So it's like, if you had an experienced guy in his corner, he would have been like, damn, we're not stopping this. And by the second, third round, you don't let it go past the fourth, because then it goes to the scorecards. You go, look, you got to stop this fight. You got to protect your fighter. You know what I'm saying? And it wasn't fair. Well, not that it wasn't fair, but, you know, Tim Zhu wasn't getting ready for a 6'6", you know, fighter. So that's a game, you know what I mean? That's a game changer. But look, regardless, Fundora fought like a champ. He deserves to be a champ. He himself suffered a broken nose, and blood was gushing profusely. So props to Fundora. I'm not saying he don't deserve to be champion. He definitely does, but I think Tim Zhu's corner mess that up.
Okay, people want to see you back in action. There's one fight in particular that fans want to see you against Berlanga.
I don't think so, man. You know, Berlanga just became mandatory to Canelo. So if Canelo does get the win, then, you know, I see him and Berlanga next. But you know what I'm saying, I see Chavez is back in the ring. What's up with that?
That'd be kind of dope. What do you tell Chavez in Spanish? ¿Qué le dices a Chavez?
No, Chavez, man, I just told Chavez, man, if, you know, I see him back in the gym. You know, look, man, we the fight between me and him should have been happened a long time ago, right? But it's like, look, we're in the course where I retired, but I'll come back. I'll come back for that one.
Take that work.
You know what I mean? So let's see what happens, man.
So thanks, Gabe. If Ryan fights Fundora, how would he approach to his hook? Where would he even land?
You don't
land?
Change like... nothing. You fight the same. You whip that hook. I mean, his hook is the Tito Trinidad effect. Tito Trinidad hit dudes with that hook. They couldn't do nothing. So, like, Ryan really got that power. And I think the more weight... If Ryan goes up to 54, he's going to carry that power. He's going to carry that power because he puts full motion into it. It ain't an arm shot. It's back. So there's more weight into the punch if he moves up in weight.
I believe Ryan mentioned that he was 160 at the fight night, right?
Yeah, I believe it. He definitely looked 160. You know, when he was sitting down, he had the little rose. All good, though, man.
You know, when he drank that beer night before the fight, so...
Who knows if it was
I mean,
a beer.
He confirmed it, but let's say, like, how would it even affect the fighter, like, when you drink alcohol the day before the fight?
No. the old school fighters used to drink beer after the weigh-in.
Ask Freddie.
They used to drink beer after the weigh-in because, no doubt, because the beer, yeah, marathon runners drink beer. Because the beer, I forget what it has. It has the, yeah, it has the carbs. It helps you put the weight back on. So it's not like you're make, you're drinking five. You're not drinking a six-pack. You drink one. Actually, look it up. Old school fighters did it. Old school fighters did all types of shit.
It seems like Ryan did everything. Like he knew what he was doing. The promotion, yeah, went, fooling everybody, yeah, drinking beer to actually be big.
And most importantly, he had the confidence to do it. Right. And confidence is big. It's another weapon.
Thank you.
Yeah, no doubt.
Ellie Seckback, reporting for ESNewsReporting.com. I'm Ellie Seckback, reporting.
ESNewsReporting.com.
I'm Ellie Seckback, reporting.